This is the Criterion Creeps podcast, and tonight we're talking about Diary of a Chambermaid from 1964, directed by Louis Bunuel. The synopsis here from Letterboxd. Celestine has a new job as a chambermaid for the quirky Monsieur Montel, his wife and her father. When the father dies, Celestine decides to quit her job and leave. But when a young girl is raped and murdered, Celestine believes that the Montel's groundskeeper, Joseph, is guilty and stays on in order to prove it. She uses her sexuality and the promise of marriage to get Joseph to confess, but things do not go as planned. So, this is a movie that I've been meaning to watch for a number of years. It's Louis Bunuel. I like that guy. It's Criterion. I like that Criterion. But it's just like never been a movie that's been like high enough up on my list of movies to watch, for me to like go out of my way to watch. So what a great excuse to doing this podcast to finally get around to watch this movie. We just watched a few weeks ago that, Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie. It was a movie that, in my younger days, I was pretty high on, thought like that movie was the real bee's knees. Watching it again for the first time in like 15 odd years, it was kind of like, oh, I've seen so many movies now. I've kind of like my taste and like overall exposure to cinema has widened quite a bit. So I didn't really know what to expect with going into watching Diary of a Chambermaid. It seemed to be that this movie had been received like okay. People think this movie's just fine. So I just kind of like, okay, well, we'll see what it's like. So anyway, I wound up actually quite liking this movie, even though it's got some stuff, some shade, a shift in it that's so dramatic. I've never actually, I think this movie's got one of the biggest shifts we've encountered in our creep.
I think I know what you mean, but continue.
So, so the first half of this movie, it's kind of like this, we call it comedy, a kind of a dry black comedy. Black comedy of this woman who moves in to this community to work for the rich guy and his family. And she's kind of like sassy and doesn't take much crap for it. She kind of puts on the airs of it, depending on who she's talking to. She thinks she's better than the job. But there's a lot of like, I guess we like kind of like with Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie, lots of like jabs at the bourgeois class and just like how they're all degenerates and perverts, conceited assholes. We've seen quite a lot of that lately between like Discreet Charm, My Man Godfrey. We've been being exposed to a lot of these sort of ideas frequently the last few weeks. And even like thinking about it, what was it called? Torchon.
Coup de Torchon?
Yeah, Coup de Torchon, yes.
Coup de Torchon.
Even, like, there's elements of, like, Joseph, for me, in the main guy in that. I don't know, maybe it's just the mustache. I don't know. Maybe I think all French people look the same. But when I think about it, there's sort of, like, this, like, kind of, like, dark tone to that movie. But I think here, it works a little bit better. Maybe it's because like, I think this movie's like a far better made movie. Because this movie looks great. It's nice, widely shot. Really nice black and white cinematography. And yeah, like I said, the first 45 minutes are like this kind of like black comedy. Just like, I don't know. With all these like dark, strange setups. And like you get the character of Joseph, who is, I started to describe as our boy, because he is like quite a loathsome man.
He's your boy, real Jared over there.
Playing at strangling kids and going on about the wogs and the Jews and talking about how he wishes he lived in Paris so he could slit the throats of a Jew every day and talking about the alternative right.
I want to directly quote that. Insensitivity warning. I believe he says the wops and the kikes, which I thought was, I was like, whoa. Because we get that in these Criterions once in a while, but I sent you a picture of that. I was like, holy shit.
Yeah, I hadn't watched the movie yet at that time, and I went, oh, something to look forward to, I guess. So, yeah, Joseph.
Joseph, good guy.
Good guy. He's definitely the creep of the week. So, yeah, like this movie, it's all like kind of these weird little episodic little observances of like the rich and stuff like that. And like, even like you get these, there's this great moment in the movie early on where it's like, we have Joseph talking to one of his buddies that they're doing their right-wing newspaper, and they're just running off their mouths, talking shit about the politics and how they run the world. And all around them, you have all these scenes of like three women who are all like busy at work. And like they're actually doing things with their time. Like there are practical things. And then you have these two guys sitting around a kitchen table bitching about stuff. And you're like, this is like perfect. This is like an encapsulation of like how life continues to this day. And that's another thing that's like really interesting with this movie. Watching it, is this movie really feels relevant to today in very strange ways. There's some like real like old men feeling up ladies' calves and saying, oh, don't worry about it. No, it's nothing weird. Just let me touch your calf up a little bit. Come closer to me. Yes, you're going to read this to me. And then you're going to wear these boots and you're going to walk around in them. Oh, don't worry. It's nothing weird. Nothing weird at all. And it's like, oh, let me polish up those shoes for you. And then he picks them up and slinks away quietly off to the bedroom. Yeah. So this movie, it's got that fetish stuff going on. Some real,
a lot of real Jarretts.
Some Jarretts going on. Uh-huh. And then we get this like hard change in the middle of the movie where there's a little girl, little Claire. She's walking home after collecting snails and berries in the woods. She is, off camera, brutally raped and murdered. And you get this like really amazing shot that's like kind of like as tasteful as this could be of just this like girl's legs with snails on them. And it's really like, whoa, like what the fuck just happened? And I had just read the, like as the movie was going on, I just happened to read the synopsis and I went like, what the fuck? When does this part of the movie start? And then it started like right then and there. And then it turns into this like Murder, She Wrote kind of like thing where it's like I started imagining this like television sitcom about a chambermaid who travels town to town, and then like she gets embroiled in like sex crimes and murders and she has to solve them, and she solves them by like marrying people or like offering her hand up in marriage to get them to confess to her. And it's just like, okay, that's quite the change. And like, and then like, so when I was watching this in real time, Chanel came home right about around the middle mark of this movie, at which point I went and made lunch for myself, and I came back, and then the little girl gets raped and murdered, and then Chanel comes into the room and sits down and starts watching it with me, and that's when it turns into this like murder mystery. And the movie has a completely different vibe to it. Like the dark comedy and kind of like Bunuel stuff kind of like vanishes for like a long time. And she was like, whoa, this is really good. And I'm like, this is like a completely different movie. Like this isn't the same movie anymore. Like it's the same characters, but like the tone and shift, it seems to be like focused now again on the novel. And I was like reading, so like, yeah, this is based on a novel written in 1900. There doesn't seem to be like a really precise, well, like not really, like there's no great perfect adaptation of the source material. This is one of three that exists. There's this one, there's the Renoir, Jean Renoir made one in like the in 46 or 44, but it's like a comedy, an American made comedy that's got kind of like broad strokes of it. I don't think it's got any of the murder stuff. And then there's like a French version that came out a few years ago that's supposed to be just terrible, like a real crappy period piece, but it's like more, I guess, more faithful to the source material. So we've never gotten a specific take on this movie, and like I've seen people kind of complain with this that it's not. Bunuel goes into business for himself, and he kind of makes his own movie and has his own ideas, like updating things like to contemporary times or contemporary-ish times with like this backdrop of like anti-immigration in France and stuff like that. So anyways, I thought this movie was pretty fascinating, really interesting. And so in that regard, it was a pleasant surprise. And I don't know, I might like it right now more than Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie. But RJ, what did you think of Diary of a Chambermaid?
What do you think I thought of Diary of a Chambermaid?
Predictably, I don't think you like this movie. But I don't know. That was my fear of watching this and being like, oh, it's another movie that RJ's not going to like probably. So let's just get it over with.
We'll get it over with? Is that why you did your homework on this one and you were prepared?
No, actually, I
you're just interested?
I actually like this movie. I thought it was really interesting.
So, Jarrett's referring to a recent... I mean, it happens all the time, but most recently it's been happening quite a bit. Like, infamously in the My Man Godfrey episode, which is just a bad movie, but apparently Jarrett and the rest of the world like it for some weird reason. So that's the most recent one. I have been known not
RJ,
to like
I want to point out
types
this,
of movies.
This very day, I had a conversation with a customer at the comic book store, and we both talked about how great My Man Godfrey is.
Oh, that's so planted. You that didn't really happen.
Nope, not at all. Not at all.
What do you get out of lying so much? These fabricated stories that are so pointed at certain things. It's like, oh yeah, My Man Godfrey. Yeah, I was just talking to a complete stranger today about that movie.
We were talking about Criterion re-releases.
Of course.
And he was saying that how he wasn't going to buy the new Blu-ray because he's already got the DVD. He doesn't like to double dip, but he loves that movie. And I went, yeah, the movie's great. It's so well written. Go on.
We'll see when that comes out and we get more listeners because there's a re-release and it's just one more movie, one more popular video of ours where I just don't like it. Anyways, I understand why you would probably think that. There's a lot of movies I don't like. However, Jarrett, I actually like this movie quite a bit. Yeah. I think this movie is way better than Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie. I think Discreet Charm is a better made movie and it's more like snappy. It's like, ooh, zinger. Like there's a lot of allusions and metaphors and things like that. It's a movie. It's a film. But I think this Diary of a Chambermaid is a lot more entertaining. People know I don't like rich people or movies about rich people feeling bad for them,
like Magnificent Ambersons, which is like another one of these
Magnificent Ambersons, yeah. My Man Godfrey, exactly. So I don't really like those movies. This movie I liked because all of the people are so loathsome in the greasy sense, whereas in like My Man Godfrey I was like, I hate all these people, but it's just because they're spoiled and bored. In this one you have the old pervert, you have the groundskeeper who's a sadist. You have the virile and insatiable husband, and then you have the wife who just hates all the maids. And I was like, I can get down on this. I don't know why. I don't know why this is different from those other rich people movies, but I liked it. I summed this movie up as foot fetishes, sadists, and perverts. So I guess it is a true creep pick. I don't know. I think there's a lot to like about this movie for the most part. So I did like it more than Discreet Charm. I think it is definitely split into two movies, and it's not jarring, but it is like, oh well, this is like a whole different movie now, because I think that first hour is definitely this weird examination of like how these people are, and I think there's a lot of really great stuff there. The one scene I like a lot is when the old pervert is like putting the boots on that Celestine, the maid. And he's like taking them off and there's just kind of this long shot on her and she's really uninterested in what's going on. She's like really bored.
Yep.
And I thought that was really like just a really good shot because
it's almost like it's like most women getting paid to do things they don't want to do. They're just like, well, I'm here and getting paid. This guy's just going to do what he does. And I'm just going to sit here and be like completely not interested and he won't even notice.
Yeah, exactly. And like I just thought that was a really just really good scene because it shows her and kind of the stuff that she's been through. And like she has that backstory too of like working for royalty and all that junk and how this is kind of like a step down almost for her. But then it's like this old guy who has all these peculiar interests. Like he's got that wooden woman in his office that's like real creepy. And he likes trying shoes on people and touching calves. But she's so uninterested in it. I was like, man, that's really good. I like that. So there's stuff like that that is cool. And I think this movie starts off, it's really weird. Like my first comment, I don't even remember what it was, but it's horse buggies and lingerie. And I'm trying to think of why I wrote that.
Okay, so...
there's a lingerie store. there's a horse buggy going through a town, and there's a lingerie store. So, and I was like, oh, that's a nice picture.
Okay, so it's interesting that you made that same note. There's something about, like, how well shot this movie is, like, right from the get-go, like, how it draws attention to weird things. Because my very first note is surly-faced coachman, which is Joseph, who's, like, the main guy. He's, like, he's the main emphasis of this movie. Like, he's, like, the last character you see in the movie, too. Like, at the very, very end, when they're singing the, like, anti-immigration chant, and he's got the store at the end. Like, it's him. And then you get the shot of her, like, tying her shoes while on the carriage. And it's just kind of like, well, that's an odd shot. But it's, like, you don't usually see that. And so they're bringing your attention to this thing. But you're also getting this long leg and the kind of, like, the runs in her leggings. And you're like, oh. So it's, like, she's kind of, like, she looks good, like she dresses better than everybody else, but there's all these little cracks in the facade that are just subtle things, but they're also kind of like things that people go like, oh, when they see like a run in the leg, they go, she's, that's a little sexy, isn't it? Like, it's just little stuff like that, and it's like, that's how that kind of reads. And then there's the shot of like the with the horse going through town. You see the breath of the horse because it's like a cool day, and it looks so good, and you're like, man, like this, like already this movie is like cooking on a cinematic level.
It's cooking with gas.
Yeah,
no, I agree. I also thought this movie was cooking with gas right off the start. So you have stuff like that. And then I think you have like what Bunuel, what for the limited amount of stuff I've seen of his, I think he has like some not like ludicrous humor, but absurdist type stuff. And it's really subtle in this movie. But there's that scene where the guy's like trying out guns and there's a butterfly lands on a branch and he just fucking blows it away with like a shotgun or a rifle or something. And I was like, that's such a weird thing to have in this. That's like a Looney Tunes style bit. I don't know. So there's stuff like that. And you're right. Like, it does a really good job in the first half of building up these characters. Like that Joseph guy, such a piece of shit. He's talking about wops. He's really rough goose handling those geese. And when Celestine's like, she's like, don't do that. Just do it this other way. And he's like, no, I like it when they hurt. And you're like, oh, fuck. This guy's a little out there. I didn't like that part, but, you know, it builds the character.
That goose was perfectly fine.
They killed that goose for real.
Well, there was definitely a dead goose. I don't know if it's the same goose, but
I imagine it was the same dead goose. But anyways, pretty rough goose handling, just shaking him by the neck. I've picked up geese before. It's not easy. But anyways, so the first half is really good. They set up all these characters and you get a good sense of who each of them are.
And then
there is this huge shift. And it's this murder mystery. I'm a little confused as to what her plan was, but I think that kind of adds to the movie. Like near the end, I guess, spoiler a little bit, like it doesn't really amount to much. And I think that works a lot better because her plan is a little confusing. It's like, well, I'm going to sleep with him. I'll seduce him so he confesses.
Yeah.
But then but it doesn't really work.
That was her whole idea.
Yeah, that was her whole idea. And it's like, that's admirable, girlfriend. But I like that the plan doesn't work because it's just like, it's like, this is kind of a dark movie. It's got those dark, like it's a comedy, but it's got those undertones that it's like, oh, that's some depressing shit. Like a little girl got raped in this movie
and killed
with her fucking bucket of snails
and described as being gutted.
Gutted. So it's got stuff like that. You're like, oh shit, this movie's playing for keeps. So. But the murder mystery stuff, I don't like as much as that first hour. So I was like, oh, whatever. I'm kind of on board with that. It's no like I really liked the autoerotic asphyxiation of the old pervert just fucking whiffing on huffing on those boots. I thought that was really funny. So when you don't get that in the back end, you're like, oh, man. But it's got some cool things like when she realizes her plan doesn't work and she's like, oh shit, so she just goes to that guy who's like, will you marry me? Well, he's like a bored rich guy, and she's like, I'm gonna
her plan doesn't work, and then so she plants evidence that it was Joseph in the woods by the crime scene, and then when he gets arrested she's like, ah, there we go. Now, oh well, this old rich guy wants to marry me. That sounds like a good enough plan. And then they're like going about their life. They're married. Life's good. And it's like, oh yeah, Joseph's getting off. There's like no evidence. He's fine. And she's like, oh shit. And then Joseph's fine. He opens up the the cafe with a pretty wife, mm-hmm. and they're going to open it up to the soldiers, and they're going to chant about, you know, chasing the immigrants out of town.
Out of town. And it's I tried to screenshot that because I thought it was really funny. Yep. It's topical.
And we get a nice hard fin.
Yeah. So that's the only other thing. I think first hour is really good. Second hour is like this totally different kind of movie. Not hour, second half.
Yeah.
And then the only knock I really have on this is I think the ending is really abrupt and it was really out of nowhere for me.
Oh, it's super hard. Like it's hard end of the movie.
But even like the revolution stuff, I felt like was out of nowhere because you're getting this scene with Celestine and she's with that guy and he's like, yeah, the guy goes, He's going to get off. There was no real evidence. And then it goes to her and she's like, oh, shit. And then it cuts to like an angry mob mm-hmm. shouting down with immigrants or something yep. like that. And then you see he's OK. And then it just Finn.
Because
yep. I was just like, where the fuck is this? Like, where did this come from? But like not in a bad way. I was yep. just like, where did this come from? But other right. than that, mm-hmm. I do think this I actually like this movie quite a bit. I thought it was good.
That's good. I'm glad. Yep.
See, I don't have horrible taste all the time.
I just sometimes with these more non-traditional types of movies that are well made, but maybe like not the most like appealing story on the face value of it, where you're kind of like, this is like not a movie that doesn't follow a traditional narrative.
Doesn't fit the masses.
Yeah, well,
like that Hereditary movie we were talking about yeah, earlier.
Where people laugh it off the screen. Yeah, this movie's got talk about diseased Paris girls. That's just like this on constant thing about yeah. just like, oh, you know, girls from Paris, you know what they're always up to. And but that's like very that's also very appealing because they must know a thing or two. There's those lines. There's like the one that's like super good because it's like, what does that mean? Like where the wife is kind of admonishing her husband because she like she doesn't get sex or she doesn't want sex. And her husband's just like a real sex pest. Mm-hmm. And it seems like he's always like knocking girls up or like getting into trouble and having affairs. And he's like, that one girl from Bibliothèque, yeah, she cost us 1,500 francs. And you go, why did she cost you 1,500 francs? And then I go, oh, one of two things. Either she had to go pay for the abortion, and 1,500 francs is a lot of money to get an abortion, or that's hush money because she got knocked up and she got sent mm-hmm. away. And you're just like, oh, yeah, these offhand little comments. There's not a lot of like, I can't believe you got that girl pregnant and you sent her, like, there's no, like, there's, it's just like a comment about you cost us money rather than like what you did to me personally. It's more like the inconvenience you brought to me by costing us some money. And there's like the comment about like, oh, the taxes for our dead father. It's like 450,000 francs. Funeral's 358 francs. And yeah.
I just like the taxes. Mm-hmm. Oh, that means the thing with the taxes.
That's right. There's
tell
like
him, Jared.
During the boot walk when Celestine's walking around in the boots. I think that's like really well done. It's like super well shot. And it all pays off with old man, bored woman, and he's going to go jerk off in the bedroom.
No, that's what I was saying. I think that part's really awesome because. It's so rare that you get to see autoerotic asphyxiation anymore.
So and yeah, it's really rare now. It used to be common.
It's just, yeah, it used to be like such a common thing. I've never seen it done on a boot. And, I thought that was really funny. I was like, nice. He killed himself smelling boots. Cause he was so horny.
yeah.
You ever do one of those?
Can't say as I have. But I'm glad the movie went in that direction when it did because it's on everyone's mind, and then they decide, yeah, we're gonna push it, we're gonna do that,
we're gonna do it, we're gonna make this guy horn dog out on that boot,
and then one day there'll be a boutique DVD line and we'll be released on there, and people will come across it and go, yeah, boot huffing perverts. So one of the things, like, so her whole plan, Celestine's plan to like ensnare Joseph the monster, and we don't even know if he actually did it.
Yeah,
I mean, all evidence in the film leads us to believe that he did. I mean, we get a nice little montage of a boar chasing after a little like boar pig chasing after a bunny, and I mean that seems pretty clear cut to me.
Well, it doesn't show you him doing it, but he does fucking run into the forest after he like looks around. So I think it's pretty safe to assume that he did do it.
Mm.
That might just be me, but
yeah. It's the big question, isn't it?
The big question.
The whole plot though, this is like for my own amusement, but so you've never watched the show Delocated, right? I might have brought it up to you at one point or another.
I think you said it was good, but I don't really trust any of your opinions, to be honest.
So there's this part of the movie, though, like where her whole plot is like to marry this killer to like get him to confess. There's this one episode of the TV show Delocated where like the main character, they literally pull a face-off moment where him and the guy they're going to infiltrate, they get knocked out, and then they actually do the thing from Face Off where they switch faces. And so the rest of the episode is like him being played by the other actor going back to his life in the Russian mob and like trying to get this information, but it keeps going and going and going to the point where like he's now married and like has had children. It's like, so he's been undercover for years, and then it's like all in one episode, and then it's like, oh hey, we got the information we needed, you don't need to be undercover anymore, and they just leave. And it's like, it's just so absurd and hilarious because it's like so messed up that like this man's life's completely destroyed and these other people. And this sort of story is like, so was that her plot? Like this whole idea that she, how far along would she gone with this? If like, what's going to happen? It's like he confesses to her and then she can go to the police. Yeah, he told me he killed her. It's like, it's like that would have been it. And he could have said, no, it wasn't me. That's that.
Yeah, it was fine. It just wasn't me, man.
I guess that's why she's only a chambermaid.
She uses what she's got to do what she needs to do.
Mm-hmm.
You ever been there?
No, I can't say as I have.
Man, have you ever lived, dude?
Been a chambermaid in a French chateau?
Well, I mean, if recent movies would, if any Timothée Chalamet movies would lead you to believe, everyone has lived in a French-Italian chateau at one point in their life.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. He doesn't. But that's fine.
Mm-hmm. Want to hear about from people who hate this movie?
If you want to tell me about it. Is there many?
There's a few. This movie's got, like I said, like this movie's got a much worse reputation than Discreet Charm.
We'll get there after you read these, but I wonder why.
I don't know. I think this movie's like pretty solid. I think a lot of people just don't watch it. And the people who do just maybe are lukewarm on it, but I think
vocal minority.
Lance, half a star. So boring for a Bunuel. Moreau stinks. That would be Celestine's actor.
She's good.
Yeah. Brandon Habes, 2 stars. A critical film in Bunuel's career ushers in his French filmmaking years. Hits all his usual bullseyes, anti-bourgeois rage, sexual perversion, satire of nationalist politics. Mm. But the effort is tepid, a bit too adrift. I enjoyed the reviews I read about this film far more than the film itself.
Backtrack a little bit. Lance seems like he gives half stars to everything.
Oh.
But he gave 5 stars to Hereditary and 5 stars to Heat.
Oh.
Yeah, that's a fun alignment of what we were talking about earlier. It's like both of them bad boys.
It's like it's really coming together. In a everything. Lance point.
Oh, everything's coming up Milhouse. You read Brandon Habes, right?
Yep.
He also gave Hereditary 4 stars.
Everyone's watching that Hereditary.
You know what he gave 5 stars?
Heat.
Heat. We'll leave it at that. Bergman's Call Me By Your Name. Moonlight. That's a good one. Okay, keep going.
So Rhett, aka Christy, aka Bog Mummy, 2 stars. An enthusiastic 2-star review. A cutting look at bourgeois culture through the lens of a woman navigating a terse, tight web of intrigue. It is political elements make this extremely relevant to our situation today. Some beautiful shots, camera work, and excellent performance make this one to see.
So wait, what is the problem? Did they like this movie?
It was an enthusiastic 2 stars. I mean, they did say that, but you know.
Well, they got a lot of criterions in their 5 stars.
Mm.
But you know what else they have?
What?
Something called young adult with Charlize Theron.
That's a good movie.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is it a 5-star film?
I won't go that far, but I liked it quite a bit.
Hit me with another one.
Okay, well, last one from film critic Mike D'Angelo. 2.5 stars. Revisited for my piece about Film Forum's Michael Piccoli retro, though I didn't wind up mentioning it because his performance here is atypically weak. This still just seems like a mess to me, frankly, with Bunuel and Carrere imposing then-contemporary political concerns onto a decades-old source for which they're in no way suited. It's as if somebody were to remake Catch-22 and make it all about Trump administration. I see what you're doing, and it's just a distraction. So they weren't into the political aspects of Bunuel's interests.
So you've mentioned this dude before, right?
Yes. Yeah. He's a hard nut to crack sometimes.
So he gave Paul Schrader's new one 3 stars, which, by the way, everyone I was mentioning has watched Paul Schrader's new film.
Mm-hmm.
But this guy also gave Moonlight only 2.5 stars.
Yep.
But also, he gave Night of the Hunter 5 stars, which people will find out when we get there. But I don't think neither of us were too hot on that film. So
yeah,
we'll get there one day. So I'm on to you, Mike D'Angelo.
D'Angelo, he's got some hot takes, man.
D'Angelo.
You should read The Thing, where he talks about how the effects of age badly.
Oh, the special effects are bad? Yeah. Oh, fuck off.
Yeah.
What a nerd.
He is a nerd. Anyways. Any other thoughts here on this Diary of a Chambermaid?
No, I actually liked it. I thought it was pretty good, man. Like, what we're talking about, first half is one movie, second half is another movie, and then it ends, and it's kind of out of nowhere. But yeah. I liked it more than I thought I was going to.
Mm-hmm.
Going in a Bunuel deep.
Outstanding.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know. After the break,
farts.
RJ is going to marry the soldier next door and live snails. Happily ever after. And Jared will be found in the forest with snails to his naked legs.